Amen, amen, amen. Apostle Parker, God bless you. God bless you. I thank God for you. I thank God for God touching your heart and doing this for me in regards to that book.
Amen.
Because it's really been in my heart to really get that message out there, because God has put many things
Amen.
In my heart, and I know God has just put it in my heart
Amen.
For me just to sit on it and Amen. Not do nothing with it.
Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to be real short. But I do want to bless you. And God has really given me a word. He's given me many words. But one in particular, there's something that's been burning in my heart.
Mm-hmm.
And it's concerning prayer. And as I've been praying over the last 3 weeks, two to 3 weeks, God has called me back into the on my knees in prayer. Because I know that's the foundation of, that's where my power is at with God. Because when you're on your knees, that's a direct communication with God, the Master, the Father.
Yes.
As a matter of fact, in the Bible, Jesus himself, all through the Bible when he was alive, he prayed at every turn. As a matter of fact, in this final hour, when everybody, his three boys had went to sleep and they couldn't watch with him for an hour, Jesus went back on his knees. And at the place where he wanted to give up, he asked God, would this cup depart from me while he was on his knees? But then he said, nevertheless, not my will, but thine will be done. See, in this life, you have to have that nevertheless. There are times and there are situations in your life where you do want to feel like giving up. There are times where you do want to throw in the towel. There's a time when you want to walk away and say, is there really a God? But when you really, really, really have God in you, and really, you really have purpose in you, you're going to have a nevertheless. Even when you feel like failing sometimes, even when you feel like cussing sometimes, you will say nevertheless.
Amen.
Even when you want to walk away and throw the towel, there's a nevertheless in you. Even when you want to give up, see, because the thing you must realize, see, in your weak place, at that place where you feel like giving up, in that place where you feel like walking away, in that place where you feel like you can't take it no more, that's the actual place where God will come down and he'll give you strength. Even Jesus, when he said nevertheless, that's when the angels came down and strengthened him. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. But let's go into the Bible, and it's Mark, the 9th chapter and the 23rd verse. And Apostle Parker was letting me know to the theme, her theme of the hour is the mission, a mission.
Amen.
And the thing that I understand about a mission is a commission, but also is an assignment.
Come on now.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So let me go to Mark 9 and 23. I'm going to read this and I'm going to drop a few thoughts in your hand.
Uh-huh.
And it reads as follows. Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believe.
Uh-huh.
And the theme or the subject or what I want to, my topic for the day is, do you know your purpose?
Uh-huh. Come on now.
Do
Amen.
You know
Amen.
Your purpose? Now, the thing about a purpose, the thing you must understand about a purpose, purpose is direction.
Uh-huh.
It's Amen. Knowing what direction to go in. And see, the problem with most people and a lot of people in church is that they don't know their purpose. And the reason they don't know their purpose is because they really don't know God. And the reason why they don't know God is because they're not reading their Bible. The reason they don't know God is because they're not getting on their knees and seeking the face of Jesus.
Yes, yes.
The reason they don't know God is because they're not talking to him.
Uh-huh.
Or if they're on their knees, they're doing all the talking and not letting him say something. See, one of the problems with people here in this world, in this life, that comes into salvation in the church sometimes is that oftentimes people bring their bad ways
yes.
and their bad habits in the church.
Uh-huh.
And unfortunately, what they will do, they will treat God or they'll treat God's people like they treat people in the world.
Yes.
In the world. Oftentimes, one of the biggest problems in this world that we live in is communication.
Come on, come on.
Communication is very, very a big problem.
Uh-huh.
Oftentimes, you have people, divorce because they don't communicate. Oftentimes you have people who lose their job because they don't communicate. Oftentimes you have parents who lose their kids out to the streets. It's because they don't communicate. Somebody say communicate.
Communicate.
Communicate is so important. And one of the things that I've learned, is that you have two people in a conversation. Now, these two people in a conversation oftentimes a communication or a conversation is when two people talk. It's when one person talk and the other person listen. And then after that person listened, in return, the other person respond. See, but the problem, and I often teach this, and I often talk about this through text or through posts, is that unfortunately a lot of people that have a problem with communication, what they will do is when you're talking to them, they have a sound in their mind on how they will respond. And oftentimes the sound in their mind is louder than what that person is saying.
Yes.
And then, unfortunately, after that person is through talking and they respond, then they respond wrong. Which causes that person who's trying to give their heart out or try to express to that person how they feel and how they think, they become upset. Because, first of all, they feel rejected. They feel misunderstood.
Yes.
And they feel ignored. Somebody say ignored.
Ignored.
How many people have been ignored? Nobody like being ignored. Because when someone ignore you, it lets you know that they're not paying attention to you.
Amen.
They don't take you seriously.
Uh-huh.
They don't value your opinion.
Come on.
See, this is so important. Why, as parents, as leaders, as people who have kids, it's so important for us to teach our kids habits, to teach our kids values and ethics. Because it's so important when they get older, it's very important when they get older that they represent not just you, but not just themselves, but also they'll represent God. And so the Bible says that train up a child in the way that he should go.
Yeah.
And when he's old, he won't depart from it. See, the problem is also there's another scripture that says that foolishness is bound up in the heart of a child. But the rod of correction will drive them far from it.
Yes, yes.
See, one of the problems with a lot of adults nowadays, while they're in jail or while they're disobedient, or they're doing it acting any kind of way, is that they hadn't been trained as a child.
Come on now.
They hadn't been corrected.
Uh-huh.
They hadn't been beaten. They hadn't been chastised.
Yeah.
And because of that, see, what happens is that as a child, the Bible says that as a baby, the Bible says that as soon as a child is comes from a mother, it says that the wicked is estranged. As soon as she's estranged from her mother, from that parent, she go forth speaking lies. Which means that you have to teach that kid how to speak right. You have to teach that kid how to act right. Because it's a natural thing for that kid to lie. It's a natural thing for that kid to cheat. It's a natural thing for that kid to just say anything to have his way. Somebody say amen. And so that's why it's so important to raise your kids in the ways of God.
Yes.
Because if that foolishness is not driven away when they're a kid, what happens is that once they grow up, that foolishness grow up. And then what was once just foolishness now has become defiant.
Jesus.
And the jail has a place for folk that are defiant. The grave has a place for folk that are defiant. This is why people in the household of faith or people in the church of God don't really listen, don't really obey their pastor, don't really listen to God, because they haven't been corrected. And they've been raised up, and now they're in the church defiant. They're defiant with rules. They're defiant with revelations. But God forbid that. So is it very important to raise your child in the fear and admonition of God? Somebody say amen.
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 Now,
amen.
When it comes to also the definition of purpose, also we have to look at there's two words.
Yes.
There's time and season.
Uh-huh.
Now the Bible says that in Ecclesiastes, the third chapter, the Bible says that to everything, there's a season.
Yes.
it is.
And a time for each purpose. Now, you have people that have come to me. You have people who go to other preachers and leaders, and they will say, I don't know my purpose. I don't know what God want me to do. And one of the definitions of the word purpose is let me get this definition here, is the reason in which something exists.
Yes.
And see, a lot of times people are existing, but they don't know their reason for existing.
Yeah.
A lot of people are walking around and doing anything. It's almost like they're walking around blind. Okay. And the Bible says that if the blind lead the blind, they are both falling in the ditch. So you got a lot of people around here are blind.
Yes.
And for that reason, they're falling in the ditch.
Uh-huh.
That's why there's so many churches are messed up. That's why so many churches are being closed. Uh-huh. That's why so many preachers are dying. And that's why so many churches are not being full with folk of people who are not saved to come to the house of God, because they're defiant.
Yes.
And they're unruly.
Yes.
And they don't know their purpose. Yes. And they're blind. Somebody say they're blind. And so the Bible says that there's a time and a season.
Yes.
And people always talk about, well, this is my season.
Uh-huh.
This is my season to go forth. This is my season to do this and do that. But let me explain to you about time.
Amen.
Now, in the definition of time, uh-huh, there are two types of times.
Uh-huh.
There's what you call chronos.
Uh-huh.
And there's what you call kairos. Now, chronos is the time that we live on. It's Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday. It's the time that's ticking right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's the time that we're living in. And see, God has given us time to get things right with our purpose.
Yeah.
See, but now you have a word called kairos.
Uh-huh.
Now, kairos is that particular point in time. It's a supreme moment. It's a moment in your life where it feels like everything has stood still.
Mm-hmm.
It feels like everything has become quiet.
Uh-huh.
It feels like everything has stood still in attention.
Yeah.
And that moment, at that particular moment, is the moment where God speaks to you. That's when the moment that light come on. Even Paul had that chronos experience. When he was going down to Damascus and he was getting ready to rescue the church again. But then Jesus hit him with a light and knocked him off and made him blind.
Yes.
And said, why are you hit against the prick?
Uh-huh.
See, the thing that you must understand, see, when you don't know your way in God, but you have purpose.
Uh-huh.
See, God will come to you. God will come to you in a certain way and knock you off your feet. He will come to you in a certain way and make you become blind until you be led, led by his spirit.
Yes.
Now, what is that blindness, you might say, Brother Peter?
Uh-huh.
Now, that blindness can be trauma.
Yeah.
That blindness can be hurts.
Amen.
That blindness can be calamities.
Amen.
That time can be all kind of things, but the purpose of it is to get your attention.
Uh-huh.
Oftentimes in life, when we keep